Hi everyone, welcome back to my YouTube videos. In the previous video, we defined the general concept of a stochastic process. I also define like specific classes of stochastic processes called martingales and Markov chain. In this video and the next one, I'm going to give you examples of stochastic processes, and for each of those ones, we are going to see concretely how we can check whether those processes are martingales or Markov chains. So to define our examples, we are going to start with a coin. So we are going to have a coin that comes up heads with probability P and tails with probability Q. Of course, we assume that P plus Q equals one. And our first example is extremely simple. It just keeps track of the sequence of heads and tails. So I wrote quickly like the definition on the board. So again, we have a coin, like say a magic quarter that comes up heads and tails with a priori different probabilities. So we assume in particular that we don't always have a fair coin. So that's those two probabilities, head here with probability P, tails with probability Q. And we just assume that WN is just going to be equal to plus one if for the nth count flip, you get heads, and negative one if for the nth count flip, you get tails. So you see that indeed this is a stochastic process, like the collection Xn is a stochastic process. That's indeed a sequence of random variables. Here, the state space is pretty simple. The state space is just negative one plus one. That's the two possible values Wn can take. And you see that in this case, we have a sequence of independent and identically distributed random variables. So I mentioned in the previous video that this is not like typically what we want to do for stochastic processes, but that's just our first example. So I'm going to start with something very easy where those random variables are independent and identically distributed. In the next examples, you will see that the members, like those random variables, won't be independent. We will lose this notion of independence. But okay, so let's look at whether this is a martingale or not, or whether this is a Markov chain or not. And so the goal here is just to see how we can apply the basic properties of conditional expectation I defined in a previous playlist to check those conditions of martingales or Markov chain. So here, to check whether this is a martingale or not, so we don't specify any filtration. That's what I told you in the previous video. A discrete time process is a martingale with respect to a given filtration. If we don't specify the filtration, that means that the question is whether this is a martingale with respect to its natural filtration. And so I remind you that the natural filtration here is this sequence of sigma algebras Fn, and Fn is just the sigma algebra generated by W1, W2 up to Wn. So W1 up to Wn. And so, first question, well, what is the expected value of Wn plus 1 given Fn? Okay, so that's to check whether the process is a martingale or not. So let's look at expected value of Wn plus 1 given Fn. And here, what I'm going to use is the fact that because of independence, okay, the count flips are independent at each step. Whether you get heads or tails does not depend on the previous count flips. So this means in particular that W1, W2, Wn and Wn plus 1 are independent, so Fn and Wn plus 1 are independent. So basic property of the conditional expectation with respect to a sigma algebra tells us that if this random variable and this sigma algebra are independent, then the best possible guess about this random variable is the expected value of this random variable, and that's it. You cannot say better than that. So that means that this conditional expectation is just equal to the expected value of Wn plus 1. Now, expected value of Wn plus 1, well, because that's equal to plus 1 with probability p and negative 1 with probability q, this is going to be p minus q, okay? The probability that it's equal to 1 times 1 plus the probability that it's equal to negative 1 times negative 1, so that gives you this p plus q, and you see that at least when p and q are both strictly positive, this quantity is strictly between negative 1 and 1, while Wn is equal to negative 1 or 1, so this cannot be equal to Wn. So this is always different from Wn, except in the trivial case where p equals 1 or q equals 1, in which case you only get tails or only get heads, in which case you have in fact a deterministic sequence, except in this trivial case, this conditional expectation here is always different from Wn, so that means that the process is not a martingale. You see also that we don't even have here a large inequality, because again, this one can be equal to plus 1 or minus 1, so sometimes that's going to be like p minus q will be larger or smaller than Wn, and so that's not either a sub-martingale or a super-martingale. So here you see that even if you have a fair coin, this is not a martingale. Don't think that fair coin means fair game. In this case, you just keep track of a sequence of coin flips. You don't really keep track of the fortune of a gambler playing a game from a fair coin, but you just keep track of a sequence of heads and tails. And so you see in this little calculation that the process here is not a martingale. So that's our first conclusion. Wn is not a martingale. Now, what about Markov chain? So what about this property of Markov chain? Now, what we want to look at to study whether it's a Markov chain or not is look at the probability of Wn plus 1, let's say, belong to a subset of S. Let's just look at the probability that Wn plus 1 equals 1, that just this event is going to generate all the possible events in the future. So it's enough to look at that. So let's look at the probability that Wn plus 1 equals 1 given Fn. So, and what we want to do is to prove that this is a Markov chain, in case it's indeed a Markov chain, it's to prove that this conditional probability is equal to the probability of, again, the same event, but given only Xn. So here, exactly like we did for Markov chain, to study the property of martingale, I'm going to use independence. You see that those two objects are independent, so that means also that this event here is independent of this sigma algebra. So based on the same reasoning, you can deduce that this is just the probability that Wn plus 1 is equal to 1. But again, using independence, if I add Xn here instead of Fn, if instead of knowing all the past, I only know the Ames count flip, again, because the outcome of this Ames count flip is independent of the next one, again, the probability of Wn plus 1, the probability that Wn plus 1 equals 1 given Xn is again equal to this. So that means that eventually this is also equal to, maybe I'm going to just write directly here, this is also equal to this given Wn. So, conclusion, the process is not a martingale, but this is a Markov chain. So, Wn is a Markov chain. And here you see that, in fact, we have something that I would say is a little bit stronger than the memoryless property. Typically, when you have a Markov chain, that means that to make prediction on the future, you can forget about the past and only remember the present. Here, that's even stronger than that, is you can even forget even about the present because all those random variables are independent. So this first example gives you an example of stochastic process that is not a martingale, but this is a Markov chain. So next example, example two, we call that random walk on the integer. So in this example, we assume that there is a particle starting at the origin, zero at time zero, and this particle is going to jump to the right with probability p and to the left with probability q. So jump by one unit at each time step, right with probability p, left with probability q. And we are going to call xn the position of the particle at time n. So I again wrote this definition here. So xn is the position of the particle at time n, and we assume that if the particle at time n, let's say, is at position x, x is going to be an integer, then it's going to jump to x plus 1 with probability p or x minus 1 with probability q. So again, main question about this process is it's whether it's a martingale or whether it's a Markov chain. In this case, you see that the state space is bigger than before. In this case, because you start at zero and you can go anywhere you want on the integer, then the state space is going to be z. Again, we are going to assume that filtration we are using to check whether it's a martingale or not is the natural filtration of the process. So in this case, to study the process, the first thing to observe is that it turns out that you can construct this random walk on the integer using the coin we used to define the first example. What you can do is just say, well, let's assume the particle is at vertex x. You can flip the coin, and each time you get heads, you move the particle to the right, and each time you get tails, you move the particle to the left. And so indeed, the particle is going to move right or left with probability p and q. So you can construct xn from this collection, from this sequence of coin flips. Now you see that because each time you have an increment, you go from x to x plus 1 with probability p, you can also say that you add a plus 1 here or you remove 1. So you can think of, in fact, xn plus 1, the position at time n plus 1, as position of the particle at time n, and you are going to add 1 with probability p, remove 1 with probability q. So in fact, xn can be constructed from the previous example, and in fact, xn is equal to the sum w1 plus w2 up to wn. Okay, so you just add 1 with probability p, remove 1 with probability q. If you look at the sum of those ones, that gives you exactly your process xn. So that's what we are going to use to study the process. So now that we understood that, so I'm going to write this. It turns out that this is equal to w1 plus w2 and up to wn. So now there are two different points of views. You can really think that we construct the process xn from this collection of independent and identically distributed random variables, in which case we said that this is equal to that by construction. You can also say that those two processes are constructed independently, but then that means that xn is equal to this sum in distribution. Okay, so I'm not going to specify anything. Let's assume just that xn is equal to this sum, and that's the way you can construct the process xn. So now it turns out that the natural filtration of the process xn is the same as the natural filtration of the process wn, because indeed, if you know w1, w2, up to wn, that's the same as knowing x1, x2, up to xn. You can easily go from one to the other. And that's by using this expression here that we can easily study whether the process is a martingale or a Markov chain. So First, let's look at the martingale properly. So we look at expected value of xn plus 1 given the past, fn. Now I'm going to use several important properties of the conditional expectation. Remember that the conditional expectation of a random variable given a sigma algebra is equal to this random variable itself if the random variable is measurable with respect to this sigma algebra, but it's just equal to the expected value if you have independence. In this case, clearly xn plus 1 is not independent of the past, okay, because the position at the next time step can be only your current position plus or minus 1. So it's not independent, but it's not measurable either, because it's not because you know where you are at some given time that you know where you are in the future. And so this random variable is neither independent nor measurable with respect to fn. However, you can use this expression here and see that this expression implies that xn plus 1 is equal to xn plus wn plus 1. Now, it turns out that xn is fn measurable and wn plus 1 that corresponds to your next count flip, it's independent of the past. That's how we are going to break this down into two pieces. Okay, so remember well this technique, that's something that we will use a lot in practice. So I'm going to just rewrite this by saying that this is the expected value of xn plus wn plus 1 given fn. So again, the interpretation is the position of the particle at time n plus 1 is just its current position plus or minus 1 with probabilities p and q. Then now I can write this down. I can say that xn is measurable with respect to fn. By definition, fn is the sigma algebra generated by x1, x2 up to xn. So xn is fn measurable. So this first part here is just xn, and then plus expected value of wn plus 1 given fn. The next count flip is independent of the past. So here, this conditional expectation is just the expected value, the unconditional expected value of wn plus 1. So we have expected value of wn plus 1 here. And again, like we had in the previous example, we know that this is p minus q. So that means that this is equal to xn minus p minus q, plus p minus q, sorry. And so this shows that if you use a fair coin, then p minus q is zero. So indeed, the conditional expectation here is equal to xn, which means that xn is a martingale. Even if the coin is not fair, then this quantity is always positive or always negative. That's a deterministic number. So that means that at least you always have an inequality. So in this case, if you have a fair coin, then xn is a martingale. So that's, you remember that this process wn is not a martingale. Now you get a martingale. You can indeed think of xn as the fortune of a gambler playing a fair game. And to see that, for instance, you can say if the coin is fair, and let's say the gambler always bet on heads, and the gambler is going to bet $1 on heads at each time step, and then the gambler is going to always win $1 with probability 1/2 or lose $1 with probability 1/2. That's indeed something that would keep track of the fortune of a gambler playing a fair game. So if the coin is fair, you have a martingale. If the coin is biased, then you still have a sub-martingale or a super-martingale, depending on whether P is more or less than Q. So that deals with this idea of martingale. Now let's look at whether this is a Markov chain or not. Here, intuitively, the answer is yes, that should be a Markov chain, because if you just can see your particle moving right or left for some amount of time, up to time n, then the position at the next time step should not depend on the past, should only depend on the current position. So that must be also a Markov chain. And to prove this properly, so we just look at a generic event in the future. So let's look at here the probability that, let's say, xn plus 1 equals x, given fn, okay, given all the past. Now you have, let's say, your vertices here. So let's say that this is your target x you want to be here, and so you have x minus 1, x plus 1 here. So you jump from x minus 1 to x plus 1 with probability p. You jump from x plus 1 to x with probability q. So you see here that that the only way at time n plus 1 you have x is if you come from x minus 1 or x plus 1, in which case you are indeed at x with both probabilities p and q. So that means that you can express this probability. So you see that's a random variable that should be measurable with respect to x0, x1, up to xn. So that means that this conditional probability is a function of x0, x1, up to xn by definition because of this given fn. And now the way you can indeed, using those random variables in the past, the way you can indeed write this probability is by saying that, well, this is going to be equal to x with probability p if you come from x minus 1. So that's indicator function of the event that xn is equal to x minus 1 plus q times indicator function of the event that xn equals x plus 1. So this rates really the probability of being in state x at time n, given that you know all the past. That's going to be equal to either p in case xn is equal to x minus 1. That's going to be equal to q in case the position at time n is, at the previous time step, is x plus 1. If you are in state x already, you cannot still be at x at the next time step. If you are further away, then again you cannot be in state x. So that's indeed the whole expression. And now from that you can indeed deduce that the process is a Markov chain for the following reason. Well, here you have an expression that only depends on xn. If you are able to express this conditional probability given all the past by only using the random variable xn, then, and not xn minus 1, xn minus 2, and so on, that means that this function is indeed xn measurable. And so that means that indeed the probability of this event given the past is just the probability of the same event given the present only. So we can conclude from that this conditional probability is equal to the probability of that xn plus 1 is equal to x given only xn, given only the present. So keep in mind for the future playlist and all the problems we are going to try to solve, that to prove that a process is a Markov chain, the only thing you need to do is look at these conditional probabilities of this form. And if you can write this conditional probability as a function of only xn without using any of the other random variables in the past, then that means that this process is a Markov chain. So to conclude this video, we are going to look at a third example of stochastic process, and this one is called the Belling random walk. So that's a variation of the random walk on the integers. So to define this process, we are again going to use the same coin that comes up heads with probability p and tails with probability q. And now we are going to assume that a gambler is going to bet at each time step on heads. Each time heads comes up, this gambler wins her bet. If tails comes up, the gambler loses her bet. And we also add this extra condition that the gambler is going to bet BN dollar on the ends can't sleep. And we assume that BN is a random variable that is FN minus one measurable. So I'm going to explain this assumption, why this assumption makes sense. So I rewrote here quickly. So we have this coin again. I kept this example one here because it turns out that this betting random walk YN can be defined from this sequence WN. And so if you think about it, so this sequence of plus and minus ones that keeps track of the outcomes of the conflict, they are going to say whether the gambler at each step of the game is going to either win and we have a plus one or lose, in which case you have a minus one. But here in this case, in contrast with the random walk on the integer, where the particle jumps exactly one unit up or one unit down, here you are going to increase or decrease the fortune of the gambler by whatever the gambler bet at the previous coin flip, at the previous step of the game. And so for this reason, you can in fact write Yn as B1, whatever the gambler is going to bet for the first game, times plus one in case she won the first game, or minus one in case she lost the first game. So that's a B1W1. So that corresponds to the gain slash loss of the gambler for the first game. Then same for the second game, you have a B2 times W2, and so on, up to BN. WN. So you can construct this betting random walk in this way by just looking at the product of the sum of the product of the bets times plus or minus one, depending on whether the coin came up heads or tails. So now let me talk about this assumption that BN is Fn minus one measurable for short. I'm just going to write that Bn is in Fn minus one. By that, I don't mean that this is a measurable set, but just that this random variable is Fn minus one measurable. So what does this mean? So let's assume for a minute that Bn is Fn measurable. So what would it mean that Bn is Fn measurable? Well, that means that Bn is chosen based on your knowledge of Fn. That means that the gambler would decide Bn, at time n. And well, this is still something possible mathematically, but this doesn't really make sense in terms of modeling aspect, because clearly the gambler should bet Bn before the outcome of the next conflict. Typically, you bet before the outcome. If not, that means that clearly you are not going to decide to bet nothing in case you lose and all you have in case you win. And so clearly you need to bet before the game, not after the game. So this is what this condition means basically. Okay, so that's the way you can construct the process. So now let's check whether the process is a martingale or not. So in the case of a fair coin, now if the coin is not fair, we can still maybe get a sub martingale or a super martingale. So let's check that. And now the idea to compute the expected value, the conditional expected value of yn plus one given fn. Fn this time is going to be the sigma algebra generated by those yn, y0, y1 up to yn. So that's the natural filtration associated to this process. So to compute this conditional expectation, we are going to use instead this decomposition. And so step one, so we need to look at the expected value of yn plus one given fn. So now you see, in view of this expression, yn plus 1 can be expressed using yn, and it gives you a yn plus bn plus 1 wn plus 1. So the increment, the random increment at each time step, it's going to be bn wn. So eventually you get that this is equal to the expected value of, so we said yn plus bn plus 1 wn plus 1 given fn. And now, now that we have this decomposition, so this random variable is not independent of fn, this random variable is not fn measurable, but here we were able to decompose yn plus 1 in, we were able to break it down into random variables that are either independent of fn or fn measurable. So indeed, again, by definition of the natural filtration of the process yn, yn is fn measurable. By assumption here, you see, if you just shift just the time here, you see that bn is fn minus 1 measurable, so that means that bn plus 1 is fn measurable, so those two ones are fn measurable, so we can extract them from the expected value. At the opposite, this one, we saw that that's the next coin flip. At time n, you don't know what is going to be the outcome. So basically, that means that after coin flip number n, right after coin flip number n, you don't know what's going to be the outcome of the next coin flip, but you know already what is going to be your bet. Okay. So that means that those two ones can get out of the expected value, their fn measurable, but this one stays inside some unconditional expectation. And so this means that eventually you can rewrite this as yn plus bn plus 1 times the unconditional expectation of wn plus 1, exactly like we saw before in example 1 and 2. We use the fact that the expected value, like all those random variables wn, have the same expected value equal to p minus q. And then that gives you that eventually this is equal to yn plus, so we said this is p minus q times bn plus 1. So that means that in case the coin is fair, then the game also is going to be fair, and we expect that we are going to have a martingale, and indeed it's the case. You see that here, this reads, so if the game, if the coin is fair, p equals q, they are both equal to 1/2, so that means that this p minus q is 0, this completely disappears, and so we have expected value of yn plus 1 given fn is equal to yn, meaning that yn is indeed a martingale. Now, if the game, if the coin is biased, like p larger than q, you have a favorable game, or p less than q, you have some unfavorable game. Of course, the bet is a positive quantity, or at least non-negative. So that means that if p is larger than q, then this whole thing becomes positive. And so this conditional expectation is larger than yn. So in this case, you have a sub-martingale. If at the opposite, p is less than q, you have some unfavorable game. And here, that rates this less than yn, and so you have a super-martingale. Okay, so what's interesting to see in this example is that if you take all the bn equal to 1, then you go back to this random walk on the integers, and then again the process is a martingale. So in case you have a fair coin, so you have a fair game, and so a martingale if you bet $1 at each game. But what's interesting to see here is that no matter what you are going to bet, okay, even if the bet, you decide the bet at each time step and it's random, as long as it depends on the previous coin flips and not, of course, on the coin flip to come, then this process is still a martingale. It doesn't matter how much money you are going to bet at each game. It's still a fair game, and the process is a martingale if you have a fair coin. So now, let's look at whether instead the process is a Markov chain or not. And so it turns out that whether the process is a Markov chain or not depends on the choice of the BN. So for instance, if that's what we just saw in example two, if all the BN are equal to one, the gambler is going to bet $1 at each time step, then the fortune of the gambler is exactly described by the position of this particle in example two. And so in this case, we saw already that the process was a Markov chain. In general, if the BN are fixed, not random, or, you know, if they are, they don't depend on N, or, you know, they are just fixed values, in general, you have a Markov chain, but then you can also find choices of those random variables in such a way that the process is not Markov. And so that's the goal here, that's what I'm going to try to do, so that we have our first example of stochastic process that is not a Markov chain. So for that, we are going to do something that kind of makes sense in terms of interpretation. We are going to fix, let's say, A, strictly larger than B, strictly larger than zero, and we are going to assume that at each step of the game, the gambler is going to bet either A or B, and the gambler is in fact going to bet A after each win and bet B after each loss, okay? So let's say that the gambler is going to bet A after each win and B after each loss. So what does it mean? Like in terms of modeling aspect interpretation, so that kind of makes sense. It's just that each time the gambler is going to win, this gambler is going to feel lucky and bet a larger amount of money at the next bet. While each time there is a loss, then the gambler feels unlucky and then is going to bet less money at the next coin flip. So of course, we know already from the previous, like from the fact that indeed this is a martingale if P equals Q, we know already from our mathematical analysis that it doesn't matter. I mean, the amount of money you bet does not matter. The game is not going to turn into your favor based on the bet you place, but it's just some kind of psychological aspect. The fact that people feel lucky or people feel unlucky. In fact, the math says that, well, there is no luck or not luck, it just, these are the probabilities and that's it. So, but it kind of makes sense to look at this model. And you see that in this case, the amount of money the gambler is going to bet depends, in fact, on whether the previous coin flip, I mean, whether the previous step in the game was a win or a loss. And so that's kind of going to depend on the previous two amount of, I mean, on the fortune of the gambler at the previous two time steps. And so because of that, we force this conditional probability given Fn to depend on the previous two time step, and that's what will force the process to not be a Markov chain. So now to study this, I might just erase here a little bit, and so we are going to look at the probability of a particular event in the future. So something that makes sense, for instance, is to look at the probability that yn plus 1 is equal to yn plus a given fn. So you remember from what I told you previously, if we can write this as a function of only yn, then this shows that the process is a martingale, is a Markov chain, sorry. But if this expression depends also on yn minus 1, yn minus 2, and so on, I mean, some of the random variables from the past, then that means that the process is not a Markov chain. So in this case, we look at this event. So that means that we know the outcomes of all the games, the fortune of the gambler up to game number n, up to the end step of the game. And then we look at the probability that at the next time step, not only the gambler is going to win, so because we have a plus here, but the gambler is going to win A, meaning that at bet number n plus 1, the gambler decided, following this strategy, to bet A dollars. So this means, we can rewrite this, that's the probability of, so the plus here means win at step n plus 1. So that's exactly the same as Wn plus 1 equals 1. But we also want the gambler to bet exactly A dollars for game number n plus 1, following this rule. That means that, so I'm just going to write this right now and I'm going to use this interpretation after, but so here we should have, to get a plus A here, we need Bn plus 1 to be equal to A. And we have this given Fn. So, now you see indeed, if you write this expression again, you see that Yn plus 1 is equal to Yn plus Bn plus 1 times Wn plus 1. And indeed, so that we add A, we need Bn plus 1 to be equal to A and Wn plus 1 to be equal to plus 1. That's the only possibility. So indeed, this event and this intersection of two events are equal. Okay, those two things are equal. Now, how can we compute this conditional probability? So you see that again, now with this expression, we were able to split like this event into two events. One event is independent of Fn, the other one is Fn measurable. So indeed, you see that if you know all the fortune of the gambler up to time n, then that doesn't tell you, that doesn't give you any information about the coin flip at step n plus 1. So that means that this event, that yn plus 1 equals 1, is independent of fn, so that should stay in the probability without the conditioning. At the opposite, with this assumption that bn is in fn minus 1, that means that the event bn plus 1 equals a is indeed an event in Fn, okay? So this one at the opposite can go outside the probability. Now, remember that probability of an event is the same as the expected value of the indicator function. So that means that this gets out in the form of some indicator function. So eventually what we get is the following. Eventually we obtain that this is equal to probability that Wn plus 1 equals 1 times indicator function of the event that Bn plus 1 equals A. So now this one, it's exactly the probability of having heads, it's just equal to P. This probability is just equal to P. But now what about this one? Well, you see that the gambler, by assumption, is going to bet A dollar on game N plus 1 if the gambler won the previous game. So that means Wn equals 1. So maybe I can write that. So that's exactly the indicator function of the event that Wn equals 1. Now, that means that we can indeed express this conditional probability using some information only at time n, but this information is given by the process Wn. Now, we are not looking at whether the process Wn is a Markov chain or not. We are studying the process Yn. So we need to instead replace this event here, the event at Wn equals 1. We need to rewrite this using only this stochastic process Yn, but saying that Wn equals 1, meaning that there is a win for game n, that means exactly that the fortune of the gambler at step n is larger than his fortune at step n minus 1. And so that means that we can rewrite this as p times indicator function of yn strictly larger than yn minus 1. And you see here that we end up with conditional probability of an event in the future at the next time step given the past is a function of not just yn but also yn minus 1. And so that means that this probability depends in fact on the previous two time step. So that shows that the process yn is not a Markov chain. Okay, conclusion of this calculation, because we have a yn minus 1 here, means that yn is not a Markov chain. And so, now if I recap from what we saw in the three examples in this video, so we saw the example of the random walks on the integers. This is an example of process that is both a Markov chain and a martingale, at least when you use a fair coin. So let's assume, for instance, that we use a fair coin. So we have an example of process that is both a Markov chain and a martingale. Then the sequence of coin flips itself, those Wn, we saw that this is also a Markov chain, but it is not a martingale. And here, looking at the Belling random walk, we have at the opposite an example of stochastic process that is a martingale if you have a fair coin, or some martingale, super martingale if you use a vice coin, but with a specific choice at least of the Bn, we saw that this process is not a Markov chain. So this concludes this video. Now to complete the picture, in the next video I'm going to give you a fourth example of stochastic process, and this one we'll see is neither a Markov chain nor a martingale.